We're looking at 1 Corinthians, and we are in chapter 7, and I'll back up a little bit, not past chapter 7, but just to the beginning of chapter 7. You know, in the first seven verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, in chapter 7, Paul turns his attention to the various marriage issues that the Corinthians had written him about, and in the first seven verses of chapter 7, it seems that some in the church in Corinth, they were urging married couples to abstain from sexual relations, presumably because they thought mistakenly that Christians should already be as the angels. Now, they don't say that specifically, but that seems to be the thought process. And that's what I went through last week and other times, this idea of overrealized eschatology, the sense that they're reading the now too much in terms of the not yet, as though, look, we should already be as the angels. And so it looks like on that basis they're saying you should abstain because we should already be as the angels in the sense of having transcended marriage and the sexual intimacy that are part of it. So you see that come up. Now, Paul says in response to that husbands and wives, they must maintain sexual intimacy to help combat the temptation of sexual immorality. Not all people have Paul's gift of freedom from the need for sexual fulfillment, which is what allowed Paul to be unmarried. So he says, not everybody, that's a gift, not everybody has that. So in a marriage relationship, they must maintain sexual intimacy. Then in verses 8 and 9 of chapter 7, he addresses, as I see it, widowers and widows, those who were once married but are now unmarried because of the death of their spouse. And he says, it's fine, it's good for them to remain unmarried, which presumably some in the church were saying they needed to do. They needed to remain unmarried. He says, no, it's fine, it's good for them to remain unmarried, but not if they're being consumed by sexual desire. In that case, they should marry. So he says that there. In verses 10 and 11 of chapter 7, he addresses marriages where both parties are Christians. Marriage between two Christians. And it seems there that some were extending this idea that Christians should already be as the angels. They were extending that idea to argue for the dissolution of their marriages. They claim that was spiritual. That was how Christians should be. And on the basis of what Jesus taught during His earthly ministry, teaching that's reflected in the Gospels, Paul tells the wives and the husbands that they must remain married. They cannot divorce for such a reason. And if they do divorce contrary to that command, then they cannot marry somebody else. As he says to the wife, she must remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband. And then when we ended, we were looking at verses 12 to 16 of chapter 7. I want to read that again. I'll repeat a bit of what I said about it, and then we'll go on from there. 1 Corinthians 7, 12 to 16. Now to the rest, first he said to the married, that was before, he's speaking to the two Christians married, then he says, to the rest. Now, to the rest, I say, not the Lord, if any brother has an unbelieving wife and she consents to live with him, let him not divorce her. And if any woman has an unbelieving husband and she consents to live with him, let her not divorce the husband. For the unbelieving husband has been sanctified in the wife and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified in the brother. Otherwise, your children are unclean, but now they're holy. But if the unbeliever separates, let him or her separate. The brother or the sister has not been made a slave in such circumstances. But God has called you in peace. For how do you know, wife, whether you'll save your husband? Or how do you know, husband, whether you will save your wife? Now here, Paul addresses the case of mixed marriages. Remember, he's responding to things that they've written to him. They've asked him things. Given him their take, how they think things are supposed to play out. And here he addresses mixed marriages, meaning marriages between a Christian and a non-Christian. And as I said last week, chapter 7, verse 39 indicates that Christians are only to marry other Christians. But just like today, when you have two non-Christians married and one of them becomes a Christian, the other one doesn't always follow, so you end up with mixed marriages. And so you have them asking him, what is the situation here? It seems that in the case of mixed marriages, you had some of the Corinthians, they were arguing for divorce, not only on the basis that, look, they needed to suspend sexual relations so they can be as the angels in that regard, but they're arguing for divorce for the additional reason that the pagan partner was somehow unclean or defiling. So the idea seems to be that, look, through sexual intercourse with my pagan wife or husband, my unbelieving spouse, the Christian is taking his or her body, this spirit-filled temple, and is entering into a one-flesh relationship with a pagan. So the spiritual thing to do, the Christian thing to do, as some apparently argued, was to divorce the pagan spouse. So it seems you have some Christians saying, no, you need to divorce your non-Christian spouse. That's the spiritual thing to do. And in that case, Paul doesn't appeal to what Christ said during his earthly ministry. That's why he says, I say, not the Lord, because Jesus didn't address the question of marriages between covenant people, the people of God, and pagans. But nevertheless, Paul says that he speaks as one to be trusted, he says in verse 25, because he has the Spirit of God in verse 40. It's not that Paul's not inspired, as I said before. Now, Paul, he rejects this argument. He rejects the argument that the non-Christian spouse defiles the Christian. I said this last week. He rejects it by saying, no, on the contrary, the unbeliever is sanctified in his or her marriage relationship with the believer. Now, that doesn't mean that they're saved. As I said, it's obvious they're not saved. That's clear from verse 16. What it means is that they are not defiling. So this argument that is being made that, listen, Christian, you need to divorce your non-Christian spouse because having sexual relations with her, in that you are taking the temple of the Spirit and entering into a one-flesh relationship with a pagan, it is this defiling relationship. Paul says that's not the case. The marriage relationship makes it so that the unbeliever is sanctified in that relationship so that sexual relations are not defiling. And then he uses this reductio ad absurdum type of argument. That's where you push somebody to the logical limits to where they're not willing to accept the logical extension of their argument. And he says, in essence, if what you were saying is true, then the children of that union would also be defiling, and that would make it impossible to have a normal family relation, which they weren't going to accept. See, so he says, you recognize already that your position leads to something you're unwilling to swallow. So that's what he's doing to them now. Then he says, though the Christian, you see, you apparently had people saying the Christian needs to leave. He says, though the Christian in a mixed marriage is forbidden from divorcing, he says in the first part of verse 15, in the event the non-Christian, the unbeliever in that mixed marriage situation leaves, the believer is to let the unbeliever go, meaning he or she is to accept the fact of the divorce. The believer, he says, has not been enslaved or has not been made a slave in such circumstances. As he says in the second part of verse 15, in that the believer is not thereby put under an obligation to prevent the divorce or to restore the marriage afterward. The unbeliever leaving doesn't bind the believer then to prevent that or to restore the marriage after the fact. It doesn't put them under that obligation. That is how I understand what he means when he says the believer has not been made a slave in that case. They're free to let them go. They're not obligated and bound to prevent it or to work to restore it afterward. Now, if that's right, I think it is, or I wouldn't be saying it. But if that's right, then in this text, Paul doesn't speak directly to the issue of whether the believer whose unbelieving spouse left, whether that person can remarry. He doesn't speak to it directly. But despite the fact he doesn't speak to it directly, I think that the remarriage is permitted in such cases. This is what's called the Pauline privilege. I think it's permitted in such cases simply because that right normally would accompany, in the ancient world, it would accompany a permissible divorce. In other words, permission to allow the divorce. When he says to the believer, let them go. So the permission that he gives to the believer would be understood to include a right to remarry unless something else was said. David N. Stone Brewer is a guy who spent a lot of time looking at these kinds of questions. And maybe 15 years ago, he wrote an article published in the Tyndale Bulletin called 1 Corinthians 7 in Light of the Jewish, Greek, and Aramaic Marriage and Divorce Papyri. And Brewer says, when Paul says they are no longer enslaved, any first century reader, now he's a specialist in this particular area and field, he says any first century reader would understand him to mean that they can remarry because they would think of the words in both Jewish and non-Jewish divorce certificates, you are free to marry. If Paul had meant something else, he would have had to state this very clearly in order to avoid being misunderstood by everyone who read his epistle. So that's why I think, though in my judgment he doesn't address it directly, I still think it's there because in that context and environment, his not speaking about it would leave the impression that they were free to remarry. Okay, do with that what you will. I think that's what's going on. Now, the permission given to the believer to allow the divorcing believer, the permission or instruction, so he says, let them go, that, however, is the exception. And that's what you're seeing here in the last part. The rule is that God has called the believer to peace, which in this case means he's called the believer to live in peace with the unbelieving spouse, to maintain the marriage bond. After all, he says, by doing so, the believing wife may eventually save her pagan husband. That's what's here. He says, for how do you know? You see, the believing wife may ultimately, eventually save her unbelieving husband, and the believing husband may eventually save the unbelieving wife. So he says, you're called to peace. You are not to, Christian, go in and say, well, she's a pagan, I'm out, or he's a pagan, I'm out. You're not to do that. But if in that particular case the one leaves, then you're to let him go. Now, in 7:17 to 24, Paul gives a principle. Sometimes when we read the Bible, we just think that whoever's writing it is just like having these mental spasms and throwing things in that have no connection. We tend to read letters like they're proverbs instead of seeing what is the letter writer, what is this flow of thought. And in 17 to 24, Paul gives a basic principle that is applicable to what he's been talking about, a basic principle that Christian conversion does not require changing social relationships. Let me read it. He says, nevertheless, as the Lord allotted to each, as God has called each, so let him walk. And so I command in all the churches. Was anyone called having already been circumcised? Let him not become uncircumcised. Has anyone been called in uncircumcision? Let him not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing and uncircumcision is nothing. But keeping the commandments of God is everything. Let each remain in the calling in which he was called. Were you called being a slave? Do not let it be a concern to you. But if indeed you're able to become free, by all means use it. For the one who was called in the Lord being a slave is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, the one who was called being free is Christ's slave. You were bought with a price. Do not become slaves of men. Let each one, brothers, in whatever state he was called, remain in this state with God. Now, despite the fact that the believer is free or is instructed to let the unbeliever leave, if the unbeliever in that marriage relationship chooses to do so, the basic principle is that the Christian should not use the fact he has been called into fellowship with Christ as a basis for changing his social relationships. In this case, in particular, his or her marital status. So that the Christian should not say, now that I'm a Christian, because of that, I can no longer be in this relationship. As far as being a Christian is concerned, as far as a person's being a Christian is concerned, as far as that is the determining factor in the decision, he's to continue in the setting he was in at the time of his conversion. You see, now that doesn't mean that a Christian cannot change his social circumstance or his social situation. It simply means that his being a Christian doesn't compel him to do so. You see, and this is part of why you see what they're saying, where people are saying, well, now I'm married, but now that I'm a Christian, I can no longer be in this relationship with this pagan. My becoming a Christian has compelled me to change my social relationship. And he's saying that's not the case. That's not how it operates. By calling a person to Christ in a particular social setting, that setting itself is given by the Lord as an appropriate place for living out one's life in Christ. God's call on a person to become a Christian eliminates their social setting as having any kind of religious significance, as being something one must leave or change now that one is a Christian. Well, now I'm a Christian, I can no longer be this way. I can no longer be married. I have to leave by virtue of my being a Christian. My being a Christian compels me to do that. And Paul says, not so. The very situation in which you are called, God has given that as an appropriate place for you living out your faith. And then he illustrates that. He illustrates the point in two ways. He illustrates that from another social setting or social categories or social relationships. He illustrates it with the case of a Jew and a Gentile. Those called having already been circumcised, Jews. Okay, so those who were Jews when they converted, when they became Christians, should not, by virtue of their becoming Christian, then say that they need to become Gentiles and have surgery to undo their circumcision. There was a surgery like that. So he's saying the fact that you were a Jew and you became a Christian does not obligate you now to be a Gentile and to mask your prior circumcision. And he tells those who were called being uncircumcised. In other words, you were a Gentile when you converted, that they should not therefore seek to become Jews, seek to be circumcised. You see, the gospel transcends the social distinctions of Jew and Gentile, bringing the two together in one body, and it thereby renders the distinction religiously insignificant. Do you see? So there's no religious, spiritual reason that as a Jew I become a Christian, that I'm now compelled by virtue of my conversion to be a Gentile. Gentile who becomes a Christian is now, there's no reason, spiritual reason, religious reason, that by virtue of his conversion he's now compelled to be a Jew. They were called as a Jew and a Gentile in those social settings, and that setting is fine for them living out their life in Christ. And what Paul, and see, there's no need for change. Whatever one was, whether a Jew or a Gentile, it makes no difference to God spiritually. So whatever one was, when one was called, there's no need to change to the other. And Paul intends for the Corinthians, he intends for them to transfer the principle to their desire to divorce for religious reasons. See, just like circumcision and uncircumcision are nothing in the sense that being a Christian or becoming a Christian doesn't demand a change from one status to the other, from uncircumcision to circumcised, circumcised back the other way. Just like circumcision or uncircumcision is nothing, in that conversion doesn't require a change from one status to the other, being married and being single are nothing, in the sense that being a Christian doesn't demand a change from one status to the other. That's what they were arguing. They were saying, my conversion compels me religiously to leave my spouse. And Paul says, not so. And he's illustrating it first with Jew and Gentile. What matters is not one's social state, but the authenticity of one's faith expressed in keeping the ethical imperatives of the Christian faith. Now, why I think Paul stuck that in there, I'm not a mind reader. But what I think is going on, I think Paul added that because he didn't want the Corinthians to turn his statement where he says circumcision is nothing and uncircumcision is nothing, where he's talking about the status of Jew and Gentile is not something that you have to switch because of conversion. He didn't want his statement that circumcision is nothing to be twisted by the Corinthians into obedience to the will of God is nothing. So he adds that and he says, the only thing that counts is this idea, is obedience to the will of God. So I think that's why he added that. Now, Paul repeats the principle in verse 20. He says, let each man remain in the calling in which he was called. You see, as far as being a Christian is concerned, as far as that's the driving factor, they can live in whatever social circumstance they were in when God called them. There is no spiritual necessity to change, contrary to what they were saying. And then Paul uses, so first he illustrates that with Jews and Gentiles. And then Paul uses slavery for his second supporting illustration. If one was converted as a slave, well, should that person then be under great anxiety because now I've become a Christian, I'm a slave, I'm caught in this social situation. Now I have to fret and be anxious because I can only serve the Lord as a free person. So now I'm torn. I'm a convert, but the Lord demands and spiritual stuff requires that I now be free and I can't. So Paul uses this. He says, if one was converted as a slave, it's not to be a source of concern. Because one's status as a slave is not religiously significant. Neither slavery nor freedom. Neither counts for anything to the one who's called into fellowship with Christ. See, the slave shouldn't consider his status a matter of importance because he's what? He's become the Lord's freedman. And likewise, the converted free person, the free person who becomes a Christian, he shouldn't consider his status a matter of importance because he has become Christ's slave. So he wants them to see that the situation, your social relationship and setting when you're called is not to be something that you are compelled to change by virtue of your conversion. And the fact Paul parenthetically notes that if the converted slave is able to become free, he says that they should take advantage of the opportunity. That makes it clear, doesn't it? That his point throughout has not been that Christians must stay where they are, but that their social condition is not to be of religious concern. You see, he says, look, if for some other reason, if you're able to get free, get free. But do not think that your being a Christian makes that incompatible. So that you cannot serve God in the status of a slave. So that you must get free or otherwise pull your hair out in anxiety because here I am, I'm trapped in this social situation and I can't serve God here. He says, no, if you can get free, do it. But your situation is not of spiritual significance. See, whether you're a slave or whether you're free, if the slave can get free, the slave should do it, but not because the slave is a Christian. That is not what is compelling the freedom that the person is seeking. There are all kinds of other reasons you may want to be free, right? But he wants them to recognize that's not something, they're not trapped, that they can serve God faithfully in that situation. Because the Lord has purchased both slaves and free persons, He's the one to whom they owe allegiance. So they must not become slaves of men in the sense of coming under bondage to merely human teaching. See, they must not become slaves to men in that sense. Particularly, they must not allow merely human wisdom disguised as, quote, spirituality, to dictate their present anxieties about the need to be free from social settings, particularly marriage. Do you see, this is what you can imagine if you're married and you've got the spiritual, quote, people telling you that you need to kiss your spouse off. Well, no, you can't. You're not really being spiritual. You're not living up to Christ's call on your life. Well, what would that do to you? It would generate great anxiety. And Paul saying, you don't need to be listening to these people who are simply trying to trap you with mere human teaching. You see, that's not the case at all. So you can live out that way. You can live in that social situation. And Paul concludes with a variation of his refrain. Each is to remain with God in whatever social state he was in when converted. That social state and situation has God's blessings in terms of its capacity for you to live out your life in Christ there. It has that ability. You can be a faithful Christian in that context. Don't let people get you anxious about that and think that you cannot be, which is what was happening. Here's how David Garland, he summarizes the situation. He says, what do uncircumcision and circumcision, slavery and freedom, have to do with marriage, divorce, and celibacy? See, sometimes, like I say, we just think, well, there's nothing. Paul's just, you know, had an aneurysm and he's just decided to write irrelevant things. But no, Paul is the person he's writing. And we try to say, what is this about? Why is he saying these things? You see, so he says, what do they have, circumcision, slavery, and freedom? What do they have to do with marriage, divorce, and celibacy? They illustrate the divine principle that no earthly status, such as one's racial heritage or social standing, is incompatible with the Christian's calling by God. Those who were circumcised when God called them do not advance their spiritual condition by undergoing an operation to restore their foreskin. Nor do those who were uncircumcised when God called them enhance their standing with God by undergoing circumcision. Slaves are no less accepted by God than are free persons. Both belong to Christ and their social status has no spiritual significance. Whether a Christian is circumcised or uncircumcised, slave or free, married or single, is inconsequential to God. One condition is not bad and the other good, nor is one condition less good and the other better. No condition presents as an obstacle to living the Christian life, since a Christian is now defined by God's call and nothing else. You see, so I think that's how Paul is giving this principle, this broader principle that goes against what they're saying. You have become a Christian, you now must kiss off your spouse. And Paul's saying, you're missing it. Whoever's telling you this, whoever's creating this anxiety in your life, they are mere men, and you're not to be trapped or enslaved in that. Now Paul in 25 to 28, really 25 to 40, he turns to another set in the letter, another set of questions, and he talks about the virgins. And I'll tell you what I think about that. This goes down, but let me take it in sections. 7:25 to 28. Now about the virgins. I do not have a commandment of the Lord, But I have a judgment as one having been given mercy by the Lord. And I think he's saying, having been called by the mercy of God to be an apostle. With mercy in that sense. He says, I don't have a commandment of the Lord, but I have a judgment as one having been given mercy by the Lord to be faithful. Therefore, I consider this to be good because of the present distress. What do you consider to be good because of the present distress? Namely, that what is so, that is the status quo, what is so is good for a man. Are you bound to a woman? Do not seek release. See, he's talking about the virgins. He's talking about those who are betrothed. But he says, are you bound to a woman? Do not seek release. Are you free from a woman? Do not seek a wife. But if indeed you marry, you have not sinned. And if the virgin marries, she has not sinned. But such people will have affliction in the flesh, and I'm trying to spare you. Now, having dealt with married people interested in altering their present situation, Paul, now he turns his attention to the matter of the virgins that they had raised in their letter that they sent to him. Now, the virgins, it probably refers to young betrothed women who, along with their fiancés, were being told again by the, quote, spiritual ones, these people who are afflicted with this overrealized eschatology, that we should be already as the angels. They're being told by the spiritual ones in Corinth that it would be sinful for them to go through with their marriages. So here they are betrothed, engaged, not quite engaged, but you get the idea, that's analogous. So they're betrothed, and yet because you have this idea, the same idea that would tell them you ought to abstain from sexual relations, you should go ahead and divorce your non-Christian spouse, saying, listen, it's spiritual, you shouldn't marry, it's wrong to marry. And yes, I know you are betrothed, but you shouldn't. You shouldn't go through with it, it's wrong, it's sinful for you to go ahead and get married. So he has people there telling him this. And Paul, he says he has no command from the Lord on this matter. But he gives his judgment as one who, by the Lord's mercy, as one who's been called by an apostle, he has trustworthy judgment. Paul is inspired. So he has no teaching here when the Lord was here, but he has trustworthy judgment. And Paul agrees with the general Corinthian claim that it's good for a man to maintain the status quo with regard to the virgins. So their idea, they're saying to them, here you are in this betrothal relationship, and they're saying it is wrong for you to follow through and marry. Paul agrees with the general view that they have that they should maintain the status quo, that the man there should do that. But Paul does so not because it's unspiritual for them to marry. Paul says it for a pastoral reason, and that's very significant. Paul says he agrees with that generally because of the present distress. You see, that's the point there. In other words, he would agree that the betrothed should not go through with their marriages. But he agrees with that for a significantly different reason. Not because it's sinful for them to do it. Not, he does it because of the present distress. He has a pastoral reason for it. Now, the present distress that causes Paul to counsel against getting married is some hardship that the Corinthians currently were undergoing. Now, we would like Paul to give us more details. They obviously knew what it was. Right? They knew what distress they were undergoing. And you have ideas, suggestions include persecution, a famine. Now, so they were undergoing some kind of distress there in Corinth. But whatever that present distress was, you can see from the following verses in verse 29 down through verse 35, the next paragraph, that suggests that Paul sees their present distress, whatever this was in Corinth, whether it was persecution, whether it was a famine, whether it was something else, Paul sees that present distress in the larger context of the hardships the church must face in the last days, in the time before Christ's return. See, he wants to spare them. He wants to spare them the increase in troubles that being married will bring during this particular spasm or particular spike in distress that they were experiencing in Corinth during this age of distress. See, so this time there is this age of distress in the last days until Christ's coming, but this age of distress is punctuated with spasms and spikes of distress. And there was one going on in Corinth, a particular spasm of distress that is going on there in this age of distress. And Paul agrees then, in that circumstance, it is wise for them not to go ahead with the marriage, because he's trying to spare them. Now, it's interesting to me in his examples of maintaining the status quo in relation to virgins, he says the men who are betrothed should not break off the engagement. See, he doesn't say there the men who are betrothed shouldn't marry. I think he agrees they shouldn't marry. They shouldn't alter the status quo in that way. He agrees for a pastoral reason because of the present distress. But he doesn't use that as an example. And I'm convinced Paul doesn't use that as an example because he didn't want to feed their false idea that it would be sinful to marry. Because as you're going to see, Paul says, no, it's not a matter of sin. It's pastoral. I'm trying to spare you. So I think that's why he doesn't do that. But he gives examples of maintaining the status quo with regard to the virgins. He says the men who are betrothed, they shouldn't break off the engagement. They shouldn't seek release from the betrothal bond. And those who are not betrothed, they should remain so. In other words, they shouldn't hunt or seek a wife. So they should preserve the status quo there. And though he agreed, as I say, that the betrothed, Paul would agree that the betrothed should not go through with their marriages in the present circumstance, in the present situation. They shouldn't do that, which would be a changing of the status quo. He doesn't include that because he doesn't want to give them fuel for their false claim that it was sinful to do so. Now, he makes clear in verse 28, this was a matter of wise advice. It's not a matter of sin. It's a matter of pastoral concern. Here's what Gordon Fee summarizes Paul's argument. He says, I agree it is good for the virgins to remain single, but that is because of the present distress. You see, that makes all the difference in the world. It's not because it's somehow contrary to some Christian notion of spirituality, like you people are thinking. No, it's because of the present distress. He says, but it certainly is no sin to marry. Nonetheless, those who marry will experience many difficulties because of the present distress. And I would spare them that. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to spare them. Fee comments, he says, what is often heard is that Paul prefers singleness to marriage, which he does in this situation and circumstance, but quite in contrast to Paul's own position over against the Corinthians, we often read into that preference that singleness is somehow a superior status. That causes some who do not wish to remain single to become anxious about God's will for their lives. Right? You have people who want to be married, but sometimes they run across these texts and they're going, and they probably have people tell them, no, it's better, more spiritual for you not to get married. And so he said, you have people who are anxious about this. Such people need to hear it again. Marriage or singleness per se lies totally outside the category of commandments to be obeyed or sin if one indulges. And Paul's preference here is not predicated on spiritual grounds, but on pastoral concerns. It is perfectly all right to marry. He says, unfortunately, our reading of the text this way cuts two ways. Our culture, especially Christian subculture, tends to think of marriage as the norm in such a way that singles are second-class citizens. For such people, this text is merely Paul's opinion and is seldom listened to at all. That too misses Paul's point. Some are called to singleness still. They need to be able to live in the Christian community both without suspicions and with full acceptance and affirmation. So I think that's a point that is worth making. But this is what Paul is saying here to them. And then Paul, of course the bell here, you know, I really would like to get this next section, but we have to wait a week. It's just frustrating when you're trying to teach something that is so connected, but that's life. All right, so now, Paul here in this next paragraph, okay, Paul is going to talk about the need to live as end time people, and it's related to this way of to this question of anxiety. He's going to talk about that, and you'll see what he's after, why he wants them not to get married in this particular circumstance of present distress, because it carries a high potential, you see, of creating anxiety over your spouse. And in this time of distress, it can then be an undue distraction from discipleship. All right, but I got a long way to go to show you that. And I'm not going to get to it, but let me read it and we'll just go till the bell rings. All right, 7:29 to 35. He says, "Now this I say, brothers, the time is shortened so that from now on those having wives should be as not having, those weeping as not weeping, those rejoicing as not rejoicing, those buying as not possessing, those using the world as not making full use of it, for the present form of this world is passing away." Now I want you to be without anxiety. The unmarried man is anxious for the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But the married man is anxious for the things of the world, how he may please the wife. And he's divided. And the unmarried woman and the virgin are anxious for the things of the Lord, so that she may be holy both in body and spirit. But the married woman is anxious for the things of the world, how she may please the husband. Now this I say for your own advantage, not that I may throw a noose around you, but for the sake of propriety and devotion to the Lord without distraction. Now, Paul here, see, the afflictions the Corinthians currently are suffering, this spasm, this spike in this age of affliction in these last days, the time before Christ's return, this spasm or this spike of affliction, it's a specific expression of the fact that we are in the last days. As you see, second bell?
Yep.
There you go. All right. Thanks for coming.